everyone, and welcome back to our weekly Crypto Roundup. I'm Natalie Stoberman, joined by the one and only William Farrington in the UK. Great to see you again, but what the heck?
It was so boring. Everything was going at such a leisurely pace this week, wasn't it? A bit too boring for my life. So I was just sitting there twiddling my thumbs thinking, no, this isn't crypto. What's going on? There's nothing happening. Certainly changed tack today, didn't it, Natalie? Been a pretty wild morning here in the UK so far, and there's likely plenty more to come. I mean, why don't I flip it over to you? What's your take on what's happened this morning? I mean, I'll give you a little bit of background. I think the Bitcoin US dollar pair has dipped around 5.5% today. Pretty big wipeout. Tons of liquidations. Just a real bearish day in general. What's your take on this, Natalie?
Well, first of all, if you go back to last week, we did mention, we won't say I told you so, I'm not even going to go there, but we did mention that this run cannot last forever. Mm. It was a good run while it lasted. And how can you not anticipate something like this coming in, even though February did close in just a hair higher than January gains? Yeah. But like, if it wasn't for February 15th, like Bitcoin really like rushing up 10%, we would have seen absolutely nothing. So hello, March. Thank you so much. But Silvergate, we got to talk about that because that's probably a really big factor behind people at least losing a little bit of confidence in the crypto market to have to sell. What was it that I sent you? It was, I literally had just been posted sometime this morning. Within about 45 minutes, nearly $200 million was liquidated from the crypto market. Yikes. So let's talk about the market movement.
Yeah, definitely. There's a real big dip following the news of Silvergate Capital toward the tail end of yesterday. And I think when the Asian markets opened this morning, the losses really just started piling up on Silvergate. Essentially, I mean, Silvergate has been around since the mid to late 80s as a traditional financial institution. Under its CEO, Alan Lane, it really dove into the crypto markets in the last 10 years or so. And it sort of pivoted itself to one of the most prominent crypto-friendly regulated financial institutions in the US. That may not have been the best idea, at least in terms of how they've handled the market, because, well, they're in a bit of hot water right now, a bit of trouble. Their market valuation has just dipped around 60%, absolutely plummeted. Essentially, it follows what they posted with their Securities and Exchange Commission, saying they may be less than well capitalized. They may not be able to operate as a going concern in the year ahead because of these massive, massive losses that they've racked up in the past year throughout this really brutal crypto winter. So, you know, we're not going to say that they're going bust or anything. That time will tell on that. But certainly it's not looking good. And the investors and not responding very well, obviously withdrawing their sums and just getting the hell out of there, essentially. And that's, you know, we've seen what happens when a crypto bank or a crypto brokerage or whatever goes bust, right? I mean, FTX, anybody? It almost destroyed crypto. And here we're seeing another major, Silvergate is a major player in the crypto space. Here we're seeing another one that is on a bit of a tailspin right now, if not worse. And that's definitely being the biggest catalyst on today's 5.5% dip against Bitcoin and the wider cryptocurrency market. So a lot of external pressure going on there, Natalie.
It is, but you're going to say, you just said, hey, you can't call it yet, but it's not looking good because not only like they still have to file, they're delaying, was it, their 10K? Yep. I have it here. Their 10K filing.
Yeah, the annual report. Yep.
Exactly. But because it's not looking good because the regulators are on their ass right now. Yep. So there's questions, there's loans that need to be repaid, regulations that the SEC is trying to get out. Like it's literally been, the SEC has just been like sticking its hand in the crypto cookie jar the last month. So like nobody is safe. So for me, I feel like the body's cold.
Did you know on that loan front, do you know who has a $205 million loan with from Silvergate at the moment? Good old Michael Saylor's MicroStrategy, who just last week was kind of putting his weight behind Silvergate, saying what a great institution they are. He's got a $205 million Bitcoin-backed, Bitcoin-collateralized loan with Silvergate, right? But the way it works is if a financial institution goes bust, sometimes those loans are brought forward and they need to be, you know, they need to be reimbursed to the debtor. MicroStrategy today said they're at no risk of doing that. I don't know. I mean, I'm not.
Of course, they're gonna say that. And this Michael Saylor, there's nothing that he's ever said to make the crypto market or his investments sound bad. This guy is so bullish on Bitcoin, but. Yeah. I mean, I've appreciated it in the past. Not a lot of people like this guy, but yeah. I think they may have met their match here.
I mean, there's a just good chance that he says, right? Well, whoever is tweeting on behalf of MicroStrategy's they say that their loan is in no trouble of being brought forward. But what happens when that loan gets sold on to another financial institution that doesn't accept Bitcoin as collateral? You know, what happens then? That's the question. Hey, I don't know the answer.
I don't think
they know the answer. I've reached out to them, by the way, to ask. And, you know, when I get a response, I'll be sure to let you know. But that's just, you know, that's up in the air. I don't know if they've thought about that. It's a concern. There's a lot of money tied up there. And Coinbase is putting themselves at arm's length now against Silvergate, too. They used to have a pretty good business relationship. Coinbase just being like, well, nope, bye. See you later. Mm-hmm. And so is almost every other, you know, well-known crypto-adjacent company. So essentially the market is basically just gone. Silvergate, nice to know you. Bye-bye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think Kraken might be the last exchange left with Silvergate, but hopefully they can get a life raft if there's enough time. But you mentioned Coinbase. Mm-hmm. Silvergate's not the only crypto entity that they've wiped their hands off Binance. Mm-hmm. They've delisted BUSD over liquidity concerns, but they didn't really explain why. Mm-hmm. What's your take on that?
Well, obviously, that actually relates back to Kraken, as you just said. So obviously the good old, guess who, SEC, forced Binance's stablecoin partner Paxos to stop minting BUSD. They co-developed the coin, so they're not allowed to mint it anymore. Liquidity concerns, but potentially it's literally just BUSD users reimbursing their deposits and trying, you know, getting their US dollars back and cashing in their BUSD, and that's just causing, you know, the good old bank run. Binance has always said they're fully backed, fully collateralized, but you know, without attestation reports, we can't know for sure. But I guess Coinbase might know something we all don't. And if they say that there are liquidity concerns, then I guess there could be liquidity concerns. And that would really be kind of ironic if that happens to Binance, considering how kind of aggressive it was on the whole FTX situation. I can just imagine Sam Bankman-Fried sitting in his parents' multi-million-dollar home right now, sort of cackling to himself. But that's certainly an ongoing situation.
Well, hey, you know what I love about Binance is that CZ Shao is literally, he gives no shits on Twitter. The other day he posted they obviously don't know how an exchange works. And he didn't even say who. They're like, they obviously do not know how an exchange works. And
the FUD is,
I can just imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah. But see, but that kind of confidence, like, they're, to me, I'm just going off of Twitter, like just the tweets that I see. And so there's really like no rhyme or reason to it. But if I had to put more confidence in tweets from a CZ Shao or tweets from a Michael Saylor, that you get more of an obnoxious, like Bitcoin is great and that's it. Or you get more of a confident kind of outlook. And because Binance has been able to ride out a lot of this crap, So I don't know. I feel like this isn't the end of Binance. BUSD is still listed elsewhere.
Yeah.
But at the same token, pun intended, it's tough. It's really tough. I'm really curious to see how Binance kind of pivots out of this. But the US is not their biggest market. Sure. So I think they'll be just fine.
Yeah, I think it certainly hit them in some regards. But I mean, they're showing as one of the few institutions that has managed to ride this insane wave of crypto volatility and come out sort of okay. In fact, they were one of the few companies that was actually hiring throughout the winter when everybody else was laying off stuff, including Coinbase. So, you know, I certainly don't think this is the end of Binance. I mean, it's going to take more than that to cut down a giant. But yeah, I mean, it'll hit them to some extent. Sure, but, you know, they'll go on. So yeah, it's all happening with them. God, what else has happened in the last day? You know, I was so concerned that we weren't going to have much to talk about, and now it's all just come flooding in, hasn't it?
That's how it goes, man. This is the crypto roundup.
What's happening with Ethereum? Something about Shanghai delay there, Natalie?
Yes, sir. Surprise, surprise. Shanghai's been pushed back to April, which means it could also get pushed back to May. But like, whatever. I would rather Ethereum take your time than rush having us to actually see the magic of the merge, which we all knew. I mean, the people that have done their research, like, you know, the merge wasn't going to like turn Ethereum into like the greatest thing since sliced bread overnight. So I would rather take its time. I want to see and make sure that its scalability and being able to like, being able to build for its updates to come, because the merge is the first of many. Just take your time, Ethereum. But at the same time, I mean, Ethereum is also been affected right now on the crypto markets. Everyone is. So like, nobody is safe. Silvergate, thank you so much. But it really hasn't budged very much. It's been sitting at $1,600dollars US very comfortably.
I actually looked at the FBTC pair, because you know, I really like keeping my eye on that. It just gives an idea of which of the two kind of benchmark crypto assets and is surging or not surging, and it's pretty much just flat at the moment. So there's not been any negative impact on the Ether token because of this delay. And as we all know, as you said, Ethereum doesn't care about delays. They delayed the, how long did they delay the merge for? Like 3 years.
You know what? And then
it went off without a hitch, didn't it? So that's what happens when you take your time. And Vitalik has always said, Vitalik being the Ethereum Don, he's always said he's a bit more of an altruist than a capitalist in some ways. He wants Ethereum to be for the masses. This is his kind of way he talks. I don't know how serious how genuine it is, but he's always been more of an altruist in terms of what Ethereum can give to the world, as opposed to it just being a kind of money making venture. So yeah, of course he's happy to delay things. But I tell you what, Coinbase might be a little bit upset, because think about it. This whole Shanghai upgrade will allow stakers to get the coins back. Yes. So much of this is being staked through Coinbase. Now when they can redeem their stake, Coinbase is obviously going to take a cut on that. And that's going to be really good for them, right? Because I mean, they're struggling right now. They're losing cash. They had a terrible 2022. So when Shanghai actually comes about, that's going to be really good for Coinbase. They're going to get some transaction fees out of it. So like, not just some, a lot of transaction fees out of that. And in fact, even JP Morgan said it could be a new era for Coinbase. Maybe a bit dramatic. I'm sure Brian Armstrong, CEO of Coinbase, is a little bit upset about delay, but he's just going to have to wait.
Right. You just got to wait. Sucks to suck, but patience is key in the crypto market.
On that note,
William, I think we touched on all the important things that happened in the week that was, and let's put a bow on it.
All right. Sounds good.
Well, until next week, my friend, you take it easy. And I know you work hard, so keep working hard. But
thank you.
Don't forget to play hard.
You too. Thank you, Natalie. Have a good one.
Yeah, you too. Thank you, everybody, for watching. We'll see you again next week.